years ago. Time flies when you're having fun. But 30 years ago in 1987, the band U2, a Christian band, last number, is a Irish band. They're all Christian, but they're not like a Christian band. All right? Anyways, it's an Irish rock band. U2 came out with their own the Joshua Tree. And the Joshua Tree quickly became, for U2 fans and others, a great, loved, beloved album. Fast forward 30 years to today. It was recently announced, that U2 is going on tour this summer. It's going to be the Joshua Tree 2017 tour. And this isn't going to be just any concert. During this concert, they're going to play the entirety of the Joshua Tree album. It has songs like Where the Streets Have No Names, and With or Without You, and I Still Haven't Found What I'm Looking For. All right, that's the album. I Still Haven't Found What I'm Looking For. That's what I'm thinking about with you today. And I want to ask the question, what are you looking for? What are you looking for in life? What are you looking for in your job or your vocation or your profession? What are you looking for in relationships? What are you looking for when you come here to worship? What are you looking for? What are you looking for are the very first words out of Jesus' mouth in the Gospel according to John. And very shortly thereafter, the second words out of Jesus' mouth come as an invitation. Come and see. These two phrases, what are you looking for? And come and see could be the lens through which we read the entirety of the Gospel of John. It could be the lens through which we read all of the Gospels of Jesus' life. What are you looking for? Come and see. Keep on reading this Gospel, and you might just stumble upon something. Keep reading, and you might discover Jesus. Keep reading and you might discover a way of life that is so radically different than the way of the world that you will find new meaning. Keep reading, keep looking, and be open to discovering. I think all of us are on a journey. All of us are on a journey where we are looking for something. And today Jesus offers himself as that something that you are looking for. To help us understand or to think about what we might be looking for, I want to focus on the names used of Jesus in this Bible reading from the first chapter of John. There are three different names used of Jesus. Right before Jesus says, what are you looking for? John the Baptist is with his disciples. His followers. Yes, Jesus isn't the only one with disciples. John the Baptist had some disciples, and he saw Jesus walking around, and he said, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And the people that he was speaking to, being good Jewish people, schooled in the ways of Judaism, would have thought, I know what he's talking about. And maybe you and I, as readers of Scripture and as attenders of church, also think, Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Maybe that kind of rings a bell in our minds too. Lamb of God. In the Jewish religion, often a lamb was taken and slaughtered. And somehow, in that, it's as if our sins died also. Okay, in Judaism. And so for John to say of Jesus, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, we're going, maybe, it's foreshadowing. like a lamb slaughtered at Passover. Maybe when we read, we're going to find out that Jesus is also killed. He's also executed. The word that came to my mind because I just got a dog yesterday or the day before yesterday. Jesus is going to be euthanized too. And somehow, like that sacrificial lamb, it has something to do with your sin and my sin being forgiven. And as we read through Scripture, we discover that, do we not? Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. And as we're reading this, maybe we discover or catch a glimpse of what we're really looking for. After he's called the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, the disciples address Jesus. Jesus says, what are you looking for? And the first words out of the disciples' mouth are, Rabbi. Rabbi. Jesus as a rabbi. And the reading that Myrna shared translated it for us, which means teacher. Teacher or rabbi. Keep reading, folks, and you're going to be introduced to the one, to Jesus, who is a teacher for his disciples back then, but for us as well. He teaches us about God the Father. He teaches us about the life that God the Father wants us to live. He teaches us values and ways that are God-pleasing and actually in line with what we were, how we were created, rather than the ways and priorities of the world. Jesus can teach us, if we're open to that, about how we are to love our neighbors and love our enemies. Jesus can teach us that we are to pay particular attention to those on the outside, those who are marginalized, those who perhaps have less than we do. Jesus can teach us the heart of God. Rabbi, keep reading, and maybe you'll discover Jesus the rabbi. Maybe that's what you're looking for. The third thing that Jesus is called in this reading is Messiah. Andrew, for whom this congregation is named, Saint Andrew, right? Andrew encounters Jesus, and he goes to find his brother Simon, and he says, Simon, we found the Messiah. Messiah, Savior. This one's a tough one. Because a Savior is someone who saves. And for us to really understand what that means, we need to understand and admit that we need saving or rescuing. It harkens back to the Exodus story, where God, through Moses, rescues the Hebrew people. Jesus continues. Jesus' whole life, death and resurrection, is a rescue mission, for he is Savior. There's an old Charlie Chaplin silent movie. I think that's all he did, anyways. In this short film clip, Charlie Chaplin plays a character who is an inmate and he's being transferred to another jail. He's on a ship, but that ship sinks somehow, and he finds himself on a deserted island. And in this film clip, you see him looking down at his foot or his ankle, and there's a shackle. And attached to that shackle, there's a chain. And on the other end of that chain is a big iron ball, ball and chain, right? And he's thinking that he wants to get away from this ball and chain. And he says, well, if I just ignore it, then I can get away. So he buries it, pretends it's not there, as if he were not shackled. And then he walks away and he falls down, right? Because he's still shackled. Well, maybe if I humor it. And so he cracks some jokes, and when the ball and chain are kind of off guard, He walks away again, and down he goes. He's still stuck. Well, maybe if I reason with it. It's a silent movie, remember? And after he's reasoned with this ball and chain, he goes again to leave. He can't get anyway. Anyway, finally at the end of this clip, after he's tried to get away and get away and get away unsuccessfully, it ends with him looking up. He had this realization that if he were to be rescued, it would have to come from without. It would have to come outside of him. That's the same with us. That's the same with us. We are. One of our confessions that we use here a lot in the hymnal, the brief word for confession and forgiveness, so it used to be called, we confess that we are captive and cannot free ourselves. Charlie Chaplin was captive and could not free himself. It had to come from outside. We are captive to sin, death, and the devil. Scripture says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That is our condition. It also says right after that that the wages of sin is death. That's our sentence. But Jesus is Messiah. Jesus is Savior. Jesus is Rescuer. And as we read in the Gospel of John and Scripture, and as we worship, maybe we'll stumble upon what we've really been looking for, Jesus the Rescuer. Maybe we'll experience that rescue in our own life. There's another nuance of name that I want to look at in this text as well. This one is not a name for Jesus, but one of his disciples. After Andrew introduced Simon, his brother, to Jesus, Jesus looked at Simon and said, "You are Simon, son of John." Yes. Matter of fact, he is. Simon, in the original language, means shifting sand. Shifting sand. Or perhaps a small grain of sand. It could be either or. You are Simon. You are shifting sand. You are insignificant little grain of sand. That's nice, huh? Thanks. But Jesus is calling him for what he was. He was Simon. But you will be called Cephas, which translated means Peter, which translated further means rock. Once Simon encounters Jesus, Jesus transforms him from a shifting sand of uncertainty or insignificant grain of sand, and places him upon the solid rock of Jesus. Jesus can do that in people's lives. Like, I changed Connor/Cooper's name, actually Gail did, to Finley. No, she did. But we changed the name from Connor or Cooper to Finley. Jesus can change our name too. Child of God. Beloved. No longer wandering to and fro, but placed upon the solid rock of Jesus. That's for you. That's for me. As we discover bit by bit, perhaps, or all of a sudden, Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, or Rabbi Jesus, our teacher, or Messiah, Savior, Rescuer. And maybe as we do that, we'll find what I believe we've always been looking for. Amen. I invite you to stand. We're going to sing the words of invitation that Jesus issued to the disciples to come and see. Come and see this one, the Lamb of God. Come and see the Rabbi. Come and see the Messiah, the Rescuer.